Good morning, all. We could ask everyone to take your seats. We know we've got some more folks coming in from the breakfast, but we've got some great panels today, and we want to get those started. First of all, I'd like to thank all of you for coming today, and for those of you who were here yesterday as well, because of course, without attendees, this would not be a lot of fun. Speakers do not like to hear themselves speak that much. So thank you all very much. Also want to thank, we had our chapter presidents around the state. We had many of them help with pulling the panels together. Morgan Streetman is going to be introducing this panel briefly and the moderator coming up. But we also had Elena who worked with the panel. We had Jordan Pratt who worked with the panel. Jefferson Knight. We had some other folks such as Rachel Norby who did quite a bit of work as well. So I just want to extend my sincerest appreciation to them. When we initially started this, Jason and Jesse and I kind of tried to do everything personally. We've soon learned that that also wasn't the best way to get it done and it wasn't sustainable. So we're going to continue to reach out. And in fact, for next year, assuming that this is the third but not the last of these that we do, we're going to be asking the chapter presidents to continue to recruit within the chapters to have folks who would like to help us work with putting this on next year. I have to speak as well just briefly and thank the Federalist Society and the national folks, Leonard and Lisa. And in fact, if anyone hasn't had an opportunity yet, there's an article in the Wall Street Journal today that is about Leonard that I believe is titled The Supreme Court Whisperer. I would highly recommend looking at that. We have a lot scheduled today. We're going to try to keep everything running on schedule. This first panel is a good panel on trade. We've got two other panels, and then we've got the luncheon with Senator Lee as the keynote. So thank you all for coming. And with that, Morgan, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Dan. As many of you know, I'm Morgan Streetman. I am the president of Streetman Law in Tampa, Florida, and also the head of the Tampa Lawyers Chapter. And I have the pleasure today of introducing Judge Jonathan Gerber, who's going to be our moderator for this panel. Judge Gerber was appointed to the 4th District Court of Appeal in 2009. Since his appointment, he served as chair of the Florida Supreme Court's Long-Range Strategic Planning Work Group, the Florida Supreme Court's Judicial Ethics Advisory Committee, and the Florida Supreme Court's Committee on Standard Jury Instructions in Contract and Business Cases. He also serves on the Florida Supreme Court's Judicial Management Council. He serves as chair of the District Court of Appeal Budget Commission and has served as chair of the District Court of Appeal Education Committee. He also serves as dean of the Florida Judicial College New Appellate Judges Program and chair of the Florida Judicial College Trial Skills Program. He served on the faculty of the Florida Judicial College Advanced Judicial Studies Program and the faculty of the Florida Bar's Appellate Advocacy and Trial Advocacy Programs. He also serves on the University of Florida College of Law Board of Trustees. Before Judge Gerber's appointment to the Appellate Court, he served as a circuit judge in the 15th Circuit in Palm Beach County. During that time, he served as administrative judge of the civil division and supervisor of the appellate division. He also served in the criminal division. Before the circuit bench, he served as a county judge as well in Palm Beach County in both the criminal and civil divisions. Judge Gerber has been recognized as Jurist of the Year by the South Palm Beach County Bar Association, the Palm Beach County Bar Association North County Section, and the Palm Beach County Justice Association. He has received Leadership Palm Beach County's President's Award and the Legal Aid Society's Pro Bono Award. He's also served as President of Palm Beach County's Inn of Court. Judge Gerber graduated from the University of Florida Levin College of Law with honors. He received his undergraduate degree from Princeton, also with honors. Please join me in welcoming Judge Jonathan D. Gerber.
Good morning, everyone. With the incoming administration, trade, for the first time in probably 25 years, is back in the forefront of policy discussions. And we are pleased to welcome this very distinguished panel of experts on the subject of trade. And let me introduce all four of them to you before they begin their presentations. First, we have Bryan Riley. Bryan Riley is a free trade advocate through his research and writing for the Heritage Foundation, which he joined in 2010. He brings years of experience in trade and economic issues to his role as the Heritage Foundation's senior analyst in trade policy. Working in the Heritage Center's Trade and Center for Trade and Economics, Mr. Riley contributes to the influential Index of Economic Freedom. The index measures 183 countries across the world using specific factors of economic freedom. According to the current index, after the last 8 years, the United States has now fallen in the world rankings to 11th, behind such world powers as Switzerland and Estonia. According to Mr. Riley, the U.S. drop in rankings is largely the result of big government spending increases and passage of a notoriously restrictive health care law, the name of which we shall not mention in this room. Mr. Riley especially enjoys being a self-described mythbuster who counters inaccurate, misleading information, which he believes hoodwinks the public and undermines free trade. He is a graduate of Kansas State University and received his master's in economics from the University of Southern California. Our next speaker will be Dr. Thomas Palley. Dr. Palley is an economist living in Washington, D.C. He holds a bachelor's degree from Oxford University and a master's degree in international relations and a PhD in economics, both from Yale University. He's published in numerous academic journals and written for the Atlantic Monthly, American Prospect, and Nation magazines. Dr. Palley currently is the senior economic policy advisor to the AFL-CIO, and he's recently started a project, Economics for Democratic and Open Societies. The goal of the project is to stimulate public discussion about what kinds of economic arrangements and conditions are needed to promote democracy and open society. Dr. Palley's commentary on his project's website has been provocative recently, to say the least. Following the election, Dr. Palley wrote an open letter to Hillary Clinton and President Obama denouncing, among other things, their advocacy of the Trans-Pacific Partnership, or what Dr. Palley refers to as just another neoliberal globalization agreement. In ending his letter to Secretary Clinton and President Obama, Dr. Palley quoted a speech from the year 1653 by Oliver Cromwell to the Rump Parliament. Quote, "You have sat here too long for any good you have been doing. Depart, I say, and let us have done with you. In the name of God, go." Unquote. And our third speaker will be Stephen Ezell. Stephen Ezell is Vice President of Global Innovation Policy with the Information Technology and Innovation Foundation, a Washington, D.C.-based technology and economic policy think tank, where he focuses on science, technology, and innovation policy, as well as international competitiveness, trade, and manufacturing policy issues. Mr. Ezell has testified on topics including U.S. competitiveness, innovation, manufacturing, and trade policy before the United States Congress and the United States and the U.S. International Trade Commission. His articles have appeared in Forbes, The Hill, Roll Call, The Futurist, and among others. Mr. Ezell holds a bachelor's degree from the School of Foreign Service at Georgetown University with an honor certificate from Georgetown's Landiger International Business Diplomacy Program. Beyond all of these achievements, however, is Mr. Ezell's greatest achievement, that is being married to a great friend of our Florida Federal Society chapter, the National Office's Vice President and Director of Lawyers Chapters, Lisa Ezell, who's here with us today. And finally, our last speaker will be Alice Ancona. Alice Ancona is the Florida Chamber of Commerce's Director of Global Outreach. In this position, she leads the Chamber's international efforts and is responsible for developing and implementing programs which foster global trade and investment for Florida. She is responsible for promoting the Chamber's international trade agenda, including reducing barriers to trade, promoting efforts to expand trade opportunities for Florida businesses and products, and expanded development of trade infrastructure to federal and state elected and appointed officials, staff and agencies, as well as within the business community. Ms. Ancona is a member of the International Policy Committee of the U.S. Chamber of Commerce and a member of the Florida International Trade Partnership. She's also the recipient of the 2014 International Women's Day Award from World Trade Center Miami, the 2015 Person of the Year Award from the Florida Customs Brokers and Forwarders Association, and the 2016 Woman of Distinction Award from the Lauderhill Regional Chamber of Commerce. Please assist me in welcoming our distinguished panel.
Thank you. Thank you, Jonathan. A few months ago, when I got the invitation to come speak to this group, I was so excited. First of all, the Heritage Foundation works closely with the Federalist Society on many issues, so I was excited in that regard. Also, I was excited because I get to come to Florida in February and love visiting Florida. Earlier this year, during the as the presidential campaign was going on, I took a vacation in Pensacola. Is anybody here from Pensacola area? So beautiful. My girlfriend is there. The beach was wonderful. And we drove from Pensacola back to DC. And I don't know if any of you have made that drive, but if you drive from Pensacola to DC, you go about 2.5 to 3 hours and you hit Montgomery, Alabama. And you look out the window, I can't remember if it's the left or the right, and you see a Hyundai factory that cranks out about 380,000 cars per year. Then you keep on going up the highway, you get to West Point, Georgia, and there's a Kia factory. It's a Kia factory that produces about 360,000 cars per year. Then you keep on going about 3 more hours up to Spartanburg, South Carolina, where Heritage's president, Jim DeMint, former senator from South Carolina. And the world's largest BMW factory is located there, produces over 400,000 cars per year. And I'm going back to Washington, D.C., where people think we don't make anything in the United States anymore. I'm thinking, do you have a vision problem? Do I need to put you on a bus and just have you drive up and down the highway and look out the roads? Because that's just a false perception. And the statistics bear this out. I looked at manufacturing output for your state, for the state of Florida. And so you go back to 1985, manufacturing output's going up, up, up. And in 1994, actually in 1993, Congress approves NAFTA, goes into effect January 1st, 1994. NAFTA, the worst trade deal in history, right? So surely manufacturing just, you can imagine the line going straight down. It keeps going up. You can't tell a difference. Now I stopped it in 2001. When China joined the World Trade Organization. And if you listen to the same shows I listen to, we're getting killed by foreign cheaters in China and elsewhere. We don't make anything in the US anymore. Everything's made in China. So again, imagine manufacturing is gonna go drop off in Florida after China joins the World Trade Organization, right? It keeps going up. And you can look at manufacturing output, you can look at overall GDP, you can look at overall employment for Florida, for the country, the lines all go up. Now, there is one exception. If you just look at manufacturing employment in the United States, manufacturing employment now is lower than it has been in the past. And the reason for that is US workers are more productive than they've ever been. So if you're from Kansas, like I am, we have fewer farmers than we used to, and nobody in Kansas thinks that's a bad thing. It's because we have the best farmers and ranchers in the world, and we have some of the best workers and most productive workers in the world. And if you can produce more goods with less going in, I think that's not necessarily such a bad thing. When I hear people talk about free trade, I don't know if when they say free trade, it always means the same thing that it means to me. To me, free trade just means economic freedom. And the goal in trade policy, I think, should be pretty much the same as any other policy. So if this was a lecture on education policy, and somebody said, you got a choice, you can pick your own schools and your own teachers, or we'll have somebody in the Department of Education design your kid's education, tell them where to go to school. I think most people would be better off making those choices themselves. And if it's healthcare, you mentioned healthcare reform. If you have a choice of choosing your own health insurance plans and your own doctors and the type of care you want, or having somebody at the Department of Health and Human Services make those choices for you, I think you're better off if you make those decisions. And when it comes to your money, if you have a choice of deciding how to spend and save and invest your paycheck, or having somebody in the Department of Commerce make those decisions for you, I think you're better off when you have that freedom. And it turns out this isn't just good for personal freedom, it's good for the United States. This is a copy of our annual Index of Economic Freedom, where we rank about 180 countries around the world. And the countries that have the most freedom are more prosperous than those that are the most closed. It's probably not a big surprise to people in this room. But the same goes for trade policy. The countries that are most open to trade and investment are the most prosperous. And those that close themselves off, try and pick winners and losers, they have less opportunities than countries like the United States or Singapore or New Zealand or Canada or Australia. Now, about 6 months ago, we had a visit from the governor of Florida to Heritage. And he did a great job. I don't know why I'm still living in D.C. I was ready to move to Florida after he was done, talking about all the benefits of living in Florida, what a fantastic state it is. And one of the initiatives that he talked about, he said they're working, my understanding is, on dredging out your ports here so you can have more bigger ships coming and going. When I hear people talk about trade and say things like we're getting taken advantage of by literally every country in the world, my thought is maybe your governor ought to stop dredging the ports and put mines there instead to keep stuff from coming and going. Because how bizarre is it to say we're going to dredge the ports, we're going to be more open to flights coming in Colombia loaded with flowers for Valentine's Day that go across the country. We're going to be the gateway to Latin America so Bryan in D.C. can get fresh fruits and vegetables in the middle of winter. While at the same time in D.C., they're trying to throw up barriers to that kind of commerce. It seems counterproductive to me, or they are at odds with each other. Last point I wanted to make, I'm going to ask a question. It's an open book question, so if any of you have your pocket Constitution, Declaration of Independence, feel free to consult it. The following lines may sound familiar to you. For imposing taxes on us without our consent, for depriving us, in many cases, of the benefit of trial by jury. Those, of course, are from the Declaration of Independence. Does anybody want to guess what line precedes those in the Declaration? I won't ask anybody on the panel. I don't want to put you on the spot. It's for cutting off our trade with all parts of the world. So to me, when you hear somebody talking about throwing up new tariffs or new border barriers or restricting our freedom to engage in trade, I think it's bad economic policy. I think it's dangerous foreign policy, but it's also the kind of policy that we rebelled against when we declared our independence in 1776. And my hope is that we will continue to embrace policies that promote economic freedom and opportunity, and not that move us in the other direction. Thank you.
Can you get a slide up? Good morning. My thanks to the Federalist Society for inviting me to speak. Let me begin with a disclaimer, which is the views that you are about to hear are my own views and not those of the AFL-CIO. you've heard from Judge Gerber that I'm not a fan of either Hillary Clinton or Barack Obama. And I gathered from the response that neither are some of you. And maybe that can help us find some common ground on the question of trade policy that promotes shared prosperity. Now, as lawyers, you're all familiar with the problem of jury bias. And in some regards, that same problem applies in the trade debate. We've all been so conditioned by the language of free trade that it's hard to get a fair hearing for the real issues. The free trade gambit is a great debating trick. First, it implies that opponents are against freedom. Second, it implies opponents are against trade and for isolation. Both of those implications are slanders. Everyone is for freedom and for trade. The issue is, what are the rules governing international economic engagement going to look like? Trade has always been subject to rules and restrictions. If you want to sell toys in this country, you cannot sell toys that use lead-based paints. If you want to sell a car, it must meet safety standards. Now, few reasonable people dispute society's need and right to impose such requirements and restrictions. The real debate is, what are those requirements and restrictions going to be? Americans used to be strongly supportive of trade, but are not anymore. Why is that? To explain why, I want to distinguish between the periods 1945 to 1980 and post-1980. In the period 1945 to 1980, trade liberalization delivered very significant economic gains. This was the period of classic liberalization under the GATT, which reduced tariffs and quotas. Trade growth was also concentrated in trade between developed economies. Consequently, it was trade between economies with similar living standards, social contracts, and social norms. Lastly, for much of that period, the Bretton Woods system ensured exchange rates were managed and capital flows were controlled. That substantially contained the problem of unfair competition via undervalued currencies, though this problem did begin to emerge in the late 1960s and became even bigger in the 1970s after the collapse of Bretton Woods. Under these conditions, trade liberalization delivered substantial gains. The key was, trade was generated by the right type of competition: product and profit margin competition, not the erosion of the social contract and social norms. Compare that with the post-1980 period. First, the focus shifted to increasing trade between developed and developing economies. This explains agreements like NAFTA, the establishment of the WTO, and China PNTR, which gave China access to the US market and enabled China's accession to the WTO. These agreements are very different from the GATT. Yes, they lowered tariffs a little bit more, but they also had major investor protection provisions. These provisions made it secure to transfer production facilities from developed economies to developing economies. The goal was not classically mutually beneficial exchange. Instead, it was to set up export production platforms from which developed country corporations, our corporations, could export back to the home country, our country. Second, the new agreements started focusing on intellectual property rights and rules governing government procurement, limitations on the internal operation of economies. That illustrates how these agreements are better thought of as global governance agreements, and the TPP was a clear illustration of that. Third, policy promoted flexible exchange rates and financial capital mobility. That opened the door for unfair competition based on undervalued currencies. These conditions created a totally different ball game. Instead of generating the right type of competition, trade now generates the wrong type of competition, of wage and social contract competition, which is often called a race to the bottom. Most ordinary Americans have finally cottoned onto this, which is why they have turned against trade. And there's an important lesson here. Outside, ordinary Americans are not against job loss per se. If the firm down the road develops a better mousetrap that puts their firm out of business, that's okay with them. They know they will benefit from the better mousetrap and will find a new job with the expanding firm. What is unacceptable is wage stagnation, deteriorated work conditions, and job loss because of competition from abroad based on exploitative, unfair conditions. So let me briefly outline some components of what a shared prosperity agenda would look like. Let me give you four concrete suggestions. First, we must get a grip on the problem of undervalued currencies and exchange rate manipulation that yields an effective subsidy to our competitors. There's room for unilateral action here, but it would be much better to institutionalize the solution via multilateral currency coordination and trade deficit management, in other words, a modernized Bretton Woods arrangement. Second, there is need for strengthened capacity to defend against traditional trade problems like product dumping. Third, there is need to come to grips with the problems posed by what I call barge economics. In barge economics, companies float their factories around the world to get access to the cheapest, most exploitable labor, to take advantage of undervalued currencies, and to take advantage of unregulated economies without standards. The notion of the barge, the metaphor of the barge, by the way, comes from Jack Welch, who talked of General Electric doing, that's what he would like, in the ideal world, to be able to put General Electric factories on a barge and float them around the world to wherever he could get that unfair advantage. That is not comparative advantage of trade theory. It is exploitation by global arbitrage. So we have to put a flaw under the global economy that stops the race to the bottom. And that means we need trade enforceable, global environment and labor standards. Fourth, and finally, trade governance agreements must be stripped of investor-state dispute settlement provisions, ISDS, that allow foreign investors a special place to sue states and governments. Those provisions fundamentally undermine national sovereignty, and they also encourage offshore investing. I think that's a provision that all of you, that's an issue that all of you should stand shoulder to shoulder on. I hope my arguments help you understand what is at stake and where we must go next. Thank you.
Good morning, and thank you for the invitation to join you. So I was intrigued at first when the Federalist Society proposed the idea of beginning this conference with a trade panel to bring a bunch of economists before you in the morning. And it occurred to me that the Federalist Society is very shrewd. They found a profession recently surveyed by Pew that is the only major profession to be held in less esteem, economists than attorneys. So I think you brought the purveyors of the dismal science before you so you can feel better about your legal work for the rest of the day. I kid, obviously, I'm a big fan of the Federalist Society. So this morning, I wanted to make a few comments about Florida's export economy and then tie that to the broader state of the U.S. and global trade and economic affairs. So, you know, as the panelists have noted, trade is absolutely vital for Florida. Florida is America's sixth largest export state and the third largest exporter of high-tech products in the United States. Trade for Florida supports 337,000 jobs directly and 2.5 million jobs when indirect and induced jobs are considered. And in 2015, Florida exported $54 billion worth of merchandise goods. That's fantastic. The problem, though, is that Florida's exports of goods have actually declined 11% since 2013. And more broadly, since 2000, Florida has lost 20% of its manufacturing jobs. Now, it's not that Florida is doing anything wrong. These are results we see across the entire U.S. economy. Over the past 2 years, U.S. exports, when real value added is considered, have declined by 7%. Manufacturing value added in the United States is still 6.6% lower than it was in 2007, before the Great Recession. And over the past 8 years, the United States has accumulated a negative $6.2 trillion trade deficit with the rest of the world. These types of results simply are not acceptable for a great state like Florida or a great nation like the United States. But they are emblematic, we feel, of a broken trade and economic set of policies that the United States has pursued over the past decade or longer. And it's not just that we've just experienced 8 years of a presidency that was the only one since World War II to fail to record at least 3% GDP growth in any year. It's that, more broadly, the United States is faltering in global economic competition. The traded sectors of our economy, which compete in global markets, are not faring as well as they used to, as my colleague Rob Atkinson and I write in a book called Innovation Economics, The Race for Global Advantage. And so if we're gonna fix this problem, if we're going to make trade great again, as I think Dr. Palley has called upon us to do, from our point of view at ITIF, we really have to fix three fundamental problems. And it's not that we believe the international trade system is broken so much, it's that we haven't put in place the right set of policies that can make our manufacturers and our exporters flourish to the greatest extent possible. And so we need to do three things. First, we need to work on better market access to give our exporters better access to global marketplaces. Two, we need to hold our trade partners to the commitments they've made in trade agreements. And third, we need better policies to support our producers and exporters. So with regard to market access and market opening, it's actually quite disconcerting that the very first move of the Trump administration was to kill the Trans-Pacific Partnership, a trade pact among 12 Asia-Pacific nations, which would put in place the highest standard rules in the world around disciplines on state-owned enterprises, best protections for intellectual property, opening digital trade, better market access commitments. This is gonna be damaging for Florida. 21% of Florida's exports go to TPP countries. So the failure to complete this agreement will be a missed opportunity for Florida economic growth. The Trump administration has signaled that instead of pursuing multilateral deals like the TPP, it would prefer to pursue bilateral trade agreements with countries like Japan and the United Kingdom. That's okay in so far as it goes, but history has shown us in U.S. trade deals recently with Colombia, Peru, and South Korea that on average it takes 1.5 years to negotiate the deal and 2 years to complete the deal. So if the Trump strategy is only for bilateral trade deals, it's very unlikely we'll see anything come to fruition in his first 4 years. And if he wants to renegotiate NAFTA, that's one thing to improve rules of origin, better access for our service markets in Mexico. It's not a good thing if the strategy there is just to impose a flat 35% tariff on imports coming in. In terms of holding our partners to trade agreements, we really believe there is a battle being fought for the soul of the global trading system. You see countries like China that are characterized by state-led capitalism and the innovation mercantilist policies of countries like China when they force our manufacturers to locate in China as a condition of market access or to give away IP or technology as a condition of competing there has done incredible damage to our economy since China entered the WTO in 2001. In fact, a recent study found that unbalanced trade with China, which is negative $3.5 trillion in deficit over the past decade, has cost Americans 3.4 million jobs, including 128,000 in Florida. When China says to Facebook and to Microsoft, you can't sell your digital services in our country, that's not what free trade is. We gotta put a stop to that. I think Trump will be very strong on enforcement. Finally, we have to put in place better policies to help American firms compete. You know, the United States is the only country in the OECD, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, to not have decreased its statutory tax rate since 2000, a period in which the tax rate, the corporate tax rate of the 39 other OECD countries has fallen by 22%. US manufacturers face a corporate tax burden that is 39% higher than manufacturers in Asia. So if we can't get our corporate tax system right, no wonder our firms are hamstrung and competing in global markets, and we see a spate of corporate tax inversions that harm our economy. And finally, what we do in Washington, we have to start to learn from smart states like Florida. As we'll hear next, Florida has Enterprise Florida, the Florida Chamber of Commerce, and the goal of this organization is to help Florida manufacturers and exporters compete in global markets and to help Florida attract globally mobile investment capital to their state. But in Washington, when we have similar programs like the Export-Import Bank, the Overseas Private Investment Corporation, the Manufacturing Extension Partnership, these programs are derided as big government. And in fact, the recent Heritage Budget Blueprint, which may become the framework for a Trump administration budget in 2018, calls for elimination of all these types of programs that are directly designed to support trade and competitiveness. And I think that would be a mistake because nations, just like states, compete for globally mobile investment, and we need to support that type of economic activity. So finally, in conclusion, if we're gonna restore faith in trade and globalization, we have to ensure that Florida's and America's enterprises enjoy a free and fair global playing field, and that American workers, in particular, are supported by programs that ensure they're equipped with the skills they need to successfully compete in a 21st century global economy. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Alice Ancona. I am with the Florida Chamber of Commerce. I am not an economist, but I am going to give you a lot of data. So I'll apologize with the length of the presentation. My goal is to show you kind of where Florida is, what our economy looks like, how we trade, what we trade, et cetera. Hopefully you'll find this interesting and helpful to the discussion that we look forward to after this panel. The Florida Chamber focused on trade beginning in 2010, and then later in 2013, we focused on trade, logistics, supply chain, just to look to see how we recover from the recession. And we saw that trade was an important area, an industry sector that was pretty significant for the state to focus on. We saw the expansion of the Panama Canal as an opportunity, so we focused on investment in infrastructure. You know, someone referenced our governor focusing on dredging our ports. The 2013 study focused on the business case for trade, how we can help our exporters, businesses, either trade more, trade better, and expand markets. And these were the three goals: move more, make more, multiply. And multiply focused on foreign direct investment and services exports. So quite simply, that was our mantra and continues to be here at the Florida Chamber. We have a foundation that looks a lot at the future. We spend a lot of time looking at doing some future casting on Florida jobs, our needs, our economy growth, et cetera. And right now we're working on a 2030 cornerstone study, and we're looking at where Florida needs to be by 2030. We need to create 2 million new jobs. This is the third most populous state in the country. We surpassed New York almost 2 years ago. Our unemployment rate is pretty decent. We've had pretty healthy job growth, but as you see what our needs are, and that's another reason why we focused on trade, logistics, supply chain, et cetera, because we saw this as an area where we can create additional jobs, and these tended to be high-paying jobs. Manufacturing was also included in that. So when we talk about trade, we also talk about manufacturing, as export manufacturing is an important part of our manufacturing portfolio. We are the 16th largest economy in the world, should we be a country. I think we hear a lot about California, but Florida isn't that badly ranked. We were 18th about 2 years ago. So we're right behind Mexico. We are a very large economy. Should we be a country? That's our size. That says a lot about the power, the strength, the depth, the breadth of how Florida and how far Florida has come, especially in the past 4 to 5 years, never mind since the recession. Someone mentioned the trade numbers before. The almost $54 billion is in Florida origin exports. Origin exports are the stuff we make. We actually move $73 billion. In terms of products. So that's product that comes from other states. We export it through our ports. That also creates jobs specifically in the logistics industry, supply chain, et cetera. We import $74 million. So we're almost at balanced trade when we look at imports and exports, product that moves. Because a lot of what we import isn't Florida destined. It's actually destined to other states. We send stuff to New York. We send stuff to Chicago. We send stuff anywhere else in the country. But those products come in through Florida ports and they create jobs. We were number three in the U.S. in export intensity, exporting 37% of what we produce compared to the national average of 20%. We do well. Our manufacturers are pretty focused on exporting, and we have the second largest concentration of exporters after California, with above 60,000 exporters. And I know that's a pretty large number, but we're pretty focused on exporting as a state. And our exporters tend to be small businesses. About 95% of them are small businesses, and when I mean small businesses, 4 to 5 people. You know, these are very small businesses that are significantly focused on exporting. When we look at who we trade with, and you've heard a lot about the conversation in NAFTA, it's been very focused on Mexico, but if you notice, the other partner of NAFTA is Canada. Look what Canada means to Florida. They're big in exports, they're big for us in visitors, and they're big for us in investment. We have 350 Canadian companies in Florida hiring Florida workers. Canada is huge. And while Mexico may not be there, Mexico's a growing market for us. Last year, we saw a 20% growth of Florida origin exports to Mexico. No, they're not buying the cheap stuff. They're buying our advanced manufacturing products. 4 additional service lines to our ports came our direct service to Mexico. Those are new service lines. We're now exporting more to Mexico than what we did before, and they're bringing in more product through here. That also means logistics jobs. But Canada's a big partner for us. It means a lot to our trade. 22% of Florida agriculture goes to Canada. They consume a lot of our ag. It's a significant market for Florida. We don't think about it, but it is a big deal. When we look at trade supported by jobs, export manufacturing jobs are a multiplier. They impact warehousing, services, transportation. In total, we estimate 30 jobs are impacted by export manufacturing. So when we talk about manufacturing jobs, yes, they're pretty significant, but they also have a multiplier effect across the economy and across other industry sectors. And then we look at exports by MSA. If you look at each region, obviously South Florida is the leader in exports for the state. Above 60% of what's exported by from Florida comes out of South Florida. But if you look at just what Miami exports, we export more than some states do. We export more than Tennessee. I mean, this is a pretty significant region. Never mind Tampa, never mind Orlando. And those are growing areas. Here in Central Florida is the number one area of growth for the state. So we're looking to see Orlando improve fairly significantly, not just on export numbers, as they become much more aggressive as a region in terms of exporting, focusing on international relationships, and beyond just tourism. I mean, they are certainly becoming much more aggressive. But the state does a lot, and our own MSAs do pretty significantly well. When we look at manufacturing jobs, many are surprised how many manufacturing jobs are in Miami. Who would think that there are so many manufacturing jobs in Miami? But they are. Now, Miami is not a growing region for manufacturing. We're seeing much more growth in manufacturing in Central Florida. But these are the jobs that are tied to manufacturing. And when you think of our export intensity, how many of these manufacturing jobs are tied to exports? That could be a pretty significant number. When we look at logistics and distribution, the Florida Chamber Foundation does, again, focus on a lot of jobs. We actually did issue a Florida 2030 jobs report, and we look at specific industry sectors. Logistics and distribution has seen an 11% growth in job creation in the past 5 years. Logistics and distribution is tied to trade. This is transportation services, this is wholesale, retailing, warehousing, et cetera. These are areas that are impacted by expanded growth in trade. Go back to that. Manufacturing also saw an 11% growth in trade in employment. while it's not as large as the logistics and distribution center sector, we are seeing a little bit of a leveling out in manufacturing. Automation's part of that, robotics, et cetera. But a lot of our manufacturing, as mentioned before, is in advanced manufacturing, and those tend to be higher paying jobs than a lot of other manufacturing sectors. We are expecting to see a little bit of a slower growth in our manufacturing sector, but we're hoping that we can compensate for that in other areas, such as addressing regulatory issues in the state, eliminating some taxing, which will help employers hire more instead of pay greater taxes. And then we looked at free trade agreements. 40% of our trade is tied to a free trade agreement. Now granted, a lot of our free trade agreements are with Latin America. We do have a very significant relationship with Latin America. I think everyone can assume that. And most of our free trade agreements as a country are with Latin America. But we've seen significant increases in trade with free trade agreements. In about a week and a half, we're gonna have our international days. We're looking at the other free trade agreements, such as DR-CAFTA, which has been a significant area of growth for Florida as well. And then we look at comparison. I think there's been a lot of talk about free trade agreements and NAFTA being a bad deal. Free trade agreements aren't great for the US, but we hear from a lot of our exporters and why many of them have manufacturing operations in Mexico. The US has 20 free trade agreements, free trade agreements with 20 countries. Mexico has free trade agreements with 45. It is a lot cheaper for them to do business out of Mexico, not just because of workforce, but because they have reduced tariffs with 45 different countries, something we don't have. These are other nations that have significantly more free trade agreements. I mean, if you look at Chile, how many free trade agreements they have with so many different countries. So we are heavily focused on international. These are the areas within the Florida Chamber that we focus on in terms of trade and logistics. As you can imagine, we focus a lot on logistics and supply chain. It is a big area for our organization. And that's it.
Before we turn it over to questions, wanted to give each of the panelists about 3 or 4 minutes to respond to anything they may have heard from our other panelists. So we'll start back on the other end with Bryan Riley.
Had 3 points I wanted to make. First, with respect to whether investment provisions should be included in our trade agreements. If you look at the text of the agreements, the language that deals with protection of investment rights for Americans that invest in other countries or vice versa will look familiar because it's almost word for word copied from the Bill of Rights and says you cannot expropriate private property without providing investment, without providing compensation. So I think one of the benefits of good trade agreements isn't just the economics, but we export our constitutional values and the rule of law to other countries. So I view that as a plus. And the idea that all these investment dollars are and jobs are getting sucked to Mexico or sucked to China, we actually have an investment of surplus, an investment surplus of dollars coming into the United States versus leaving the United States. About 6 million people in the United States work for subsidiaries of foreign companies that have chosen to invest here. So if we have good policies here, we're gonna attract more of those kinds of jobs. Now there might be, some people might view it as a problem, that lots of those investment dollars go to the federal government. And if treasury bonds counted as an export, one of our biggest exports would be treasury bonds. So we buy goods from China and they turn around and loan it to the federal government. But you can blame China for that. I think that I would look at Washington, D.C. and excessive spending as a more likely culprit. And then the last point, this has been alluded to some, is that other countries have, I'm just going to say, stupid policies. Whether they devalue their currency, whether they restrict the freedom of their people to trade with us, and we should encourage changes to those policies. But with respect to the United States, the most important changes we can make, we have control of. If we fix our tax rates so we don't have the highest corporate income tax in the world, if we fix our regulations so it's easier to start a business, if we improve our education system so people are trained to take advantage of new jobs, American companies can compete with anybody in the world. And that's where I think our focus should be.
Dr. Powell?
Yeah, well, unfortunately, I think that we're very much talking past each other. The question is the nature of the trading system and its capacity to generate shared prosperity. And I don't hear that in this debate at all. I hear a little bit of sort of some incentives to how we could change incentives so that, you know, corporations could capture a little bit bigger profit share. We've just referred to the tax stuff here. The falling tax rates around the world are reflective of a race to the bottom in the tax systems that are causing, that's another dimension to the problems that I didn't even talk about. But how do we put a floor underneath this race to the bottom that is driving Americans against trade? Driving Americans against trade and will have tremendous bad consequences beyond this, because Americans, I actually think, they're not economists, you're not economists. It's just one of those pieces where they get that's their lens on the economy, and then they then diffuse that understanding through the economy at large, and it's gonna bad economics and bad, worse politics to come. Now, what about some of the specifics here? Basically, I heard a lot of argument by anecdote. I mean, the Kia, BMW, that doesn't tell us anything about the national economy. And in a sense, the same is true a little bit about the stuff from Florida. You don't understand the trading system by focusing on Florida, which is a large coastal state. It's gonna have a very distorted look of what the thing is. It's naturally a lot of stuff is gonna go through Florida. And I turn to the manufacturing data, which I know a little bit about. Well, let's talk about that. What Bryan showed us was some manufacturing output data. Notice it was output, not employment. Florida has a lot of special factors going to it. It's a state that's had massive population growth, the fastest, along probably with Texas, in the country. You're going to see, naturally, manufacturing output of things like non-durable goods increasing locally. And manufacturing data is very difficult to understand. Manufacturing increasingly embeds computer chip technology. I don't know, any little gadget you buy in your household will probably have computer chip technology. You have to deflate the value of the output to get the measure. As computers, the chips collapse in prices due to technology, that implicitly increases the value of manufacturing output. But it's driven by chip technology, not the quantity of production in the economy as a whole. So the GDP deflator. There's the problem of how to even assess manufacturing, you've got a fundamental counterfactual. What would it look like had we pursued a different course? This is as you as lawyers would grapple with that sort of thing. Let me put it in front of you very clearly. We have a trade deficit today in the country of about $600 billion. Since our oil production has increased, it's very substantially now manufacturing. $600 billion is about, I think in the back of my mind, about 3.5% of GDP. If you say that trade has had, and trade has been the prime driver of the trade rules, exchange rates, the things I talked about have been the driver of that trade deficit. To say it has had no effect on manufacturing employment is analogous to making the argument that we could increase our manufacturing production, replace that deficit by $600 billion, which is about 25% of total manufacturing output in the country, and not hire a single fresh new manufacturing worker. If you buy that, I've got a bridge to sell you. And I'll tell you more. Of that $600 billion, that tends to be slightly more labor-intensive output. We do specialize in more capital-intensive production. So the number of jobs in our trade deficit is huge, staggering, just on a static basis. Had we pursued a different trade policy of the sort of things that I've been talking about, who knows what the counterfactual would have looked like. But I believe it would have looked a much larger manufacturing sector, faster growth, because manufacturing is an engine of growth in the economy at large, higher wages, and a much happier political economy in general. Thank you.
Sometimes judges let lawyers fight in court because it's just entertaining to us. So before I turn it over to my left, I'll turn it back to Bryan because I know he wanted to respond.
My question, this phrase, race to the bottom. Global poverty rates have declined dramatically. Hundreds of millions of people have been lifted out of the lowest poverty of earning a dollar less a day. And we have a long way to go. But worldwide, the numbers as I see them, There's much less poverty today than there was 20 years ago, 30 years ago, and if that's a race to the bottom, we need to keep going.
Do I get to respond to that?
1 second.
Steve.
So, since 2000, the United States has lost 6.7 million manufacturing jobs. And our research shows that about 67% of that job loss is a result of trade, not about productivity or automation improvements. In fact, what you can do is you can look at the decade of 1990 to 2000, and then 2000 to 2010, and you see that manufacturing productivity growth was the same across both decades, about 58%. But in the decade of 1990 to 2000, we lost 4% of US manufacturing jobs. From 2000 to 2010, we lost 33% of manufacturing jobs. That's an indication that it's not automation that is the biggest problem. It's unfair trade practices and import competition to some extent with our international trade partners. So I would agree with Dr. Palley that there is a real effect of unfair trade competition on US manufacturing job loss. I do agree with Bryan, though, that we can point to the other side. Fully 20% of US manufacturing employment is workers who are employed by foreign headquartered countries operating in the United States. So there is an important role of foreign direct investment to play. But you know, from our point of view at ITIF, this is very reflective of what we see as kind of the Manichean debate about trade, which kind of can be characterized as what John Gardner called uncritical lovers and unliving critics, right? So pro-free trade are uncritical lovers, right? They see no flaws in the system. Trade will always lead to optimal global outcomes of consumer welfare because you do it on a comparative advantage, it produces wealth for all. And then you have unloving critics on the other side who can't see what the good things that trade agreements like the TPP can bring. So I do think we need to find a middle ground. And from the political economy of trade in the United States, I don't think the issue is that the structure of international trade itself is problematic or the US looking to negotiate TPP deals is problematic. The problem is that Americans look out in the world and they see a country like China that isn't engaging in the fundamental reciprocal principles of free trade based on national treatment and transparency. I'll give you very briefly an example here. China's 13th five-year plan calls for the country to eliminate US exports of semiconductors to the country by 2030. China's investing $160 billion in a national IC plan. And the direct intent of this is to completely replace US exports of advanced technology products like semiconductors to China. So what this country wants, essentially, is an autarkic domestic economy, yet the right on an unfettered basis to sell its products into the global economy. And I think Americans see that when we're dealing with countries that are playing us that way, that's fundamentally not right. And so the challenge for policymakers is to come up with a more sophisticated narrative of trade that, as I tried to say, gets two parts of the equation right, making sure that our partners live up to the commitments they have signed up to, because if they do so, then we'll be able to export a lot more of our products to China and take care of that trade balance. But at the same time, ensuring that we have the best possible policies to ensure that our companies can compete, because it's not a race to the bottom. Sweden, a socialist basket case, now has a corporate tax rate of 18%. Sweden decided to get competitive. You talk to the head of the Swedish labor union, what they say is our unions don't fear old technology. Our unions don't fear new technology. They fear old technology. They want to ensure that their companies are globally competitive because they're using the latest technologies and latest automation, because if they're putting those systems in place, then they can compete effectively in global markets. So it's not about the race to the bottom. It's about us competing with the best countries on that basis.
Before I turn it back to Dr. Palley to bring to the last word, Alice, did you want to respond?
Yes, and I know we've had a lot of this conversation on manufacturing, but international trade also includes services exports. The U.S. economy runs a surplus on services exports. We've also attracted a significant amount of foreign direct investment. I think over $400 billion, and I think our trade deficit is probably higher than 600, I think it's closer to 7 on the manufacturing goods export side, but on the services exports, we're at $230 billion, I estimate. On foreign direct investment, it's 400 and something. So while, you know, when you add in other factors, there's jobs being created in other sectors that are tied to trade. It has impacted manufacturing, for sure. I don't think anyone can say, no, trade does not impact manufacturing jobs. But it also benefits other sector jobs. And services exports are services export data is actually notoriously pretty bad. We're assuming that it's undercounted pretty significantly. Services exports are pretty difficult to count. You're all service providers. And any one of your firms, especially those that are working for firms that do work with foreign customers, you know, some of that, those transactions can count as a services export. We do a lot of services exports out of the state of Florida. And nationwide, there's a lot of services exports, and it is a surplus. So there are other sides of trade that we haven't really covered, but I think it's important to mention that there are other sectors that have benefited from trade.
Thank you. Dr. Palley, before we open it up to questions.
Great, thanks. Well, let me say, Manichaean debate, unloving critics, I don't think so. I began my talk with a really saying just how good trade can be if done under the right institutional arrangements. So
please understand, I was trying to contextualize the broader policy debate in those terms and not contextualize your remarks.
What about this poverty argument? Well, look, we brought down world poverty between 1945 and 1980. Growth was fast. It was actually slightly faster, certainly in the northern developed economies, and actually probably it's difficult about to say that the world as a whole, it's been pretty flat. But what we do know is as we've gotten deeper into these trade agreements, the global growth rate has been falling off and falling off fast. So there would have been a process of taking people out of poverty through the process of growth anyway. On top of that, the last 30 years saw the end of socialism in economic socialism in China, the former countries of the Soviet Union, and India, of course, modernized its economy. So there's been a shift to market economies. This is not about trade. This is actually about the internal functioning of those economies. And there's been a tremendous amount of technology that would have done great things for these countries as a whole. So the falling off of the falling of global poverty is a fantastic thing, but it would have gone on anyway, and it might have gone on, fallen much faster under a different set of rules. But the big point is, we are in the United States. A government looks after its people. And what is it doing? What are these arrangements doing to the people of the United States? That should be our first and foremost thing. It's rather odd hearing Bryan sounds like he wants a seat at the United Nations or something like that. Here's a metaphor you. It's not a perfect metaphor, but it sort of can get to help you understand it. Think of two swimming pools. One full of water, the other empty, and they're next to each other. Knock down the wall in between, and which way is the water going to flow? And that's sort of what's been going on between some of the economies in the world, particularly China and the United States. Now, it's not a perfect metaphor. There are benefits going in the other way, and that doesn't happen in there. But that's the metaphor to take away from this debate. If we want trade to work in the United States and bring back popular support for it and put a head to the ugly politics that is being released by this system that is failing for working people and running up against disappointed expectations, we've got to put in place the type of arrangements that I sort of briefly outlined in my comments. Thank you.
Do we have any questions for our panel? We've got about 5 minutes for questions. Representative Domino.
Thank you. My name is Carl Domino. I guess my question has to do with Mr. Palley, because I believe if he had not been on the panel, we never would have heard about currency as a factor in international trade. In my mind, that's the biggest factor. And I'm going to get to a question very quickly, but the theory is with floating rates that they are self-correcting mechanisms. You run a deficit, then your currency goes down, you can export. But the problem is the monetary policies of most of the countries have now affected rates more than the self-correcting mechanism. So you could say that NAFTA, where I understand the ratio of Mexico to America's currency is moved by fivefold, probably the biggest single factor. On the other hand, we have an example of tethered rates in the European Union. And two things has happened there. The southern countries, being tied into the German experience, basically are out of business. They only stay in business for two reasons. One is Germany gives them money, buys their sovereign debt. And then secondly, with quantitative easing, they've bought so much of the free-floating bonds that they're now talking, or have started buying, original issue bonds for both sovereign and corporate debt. As a consequence, rates are negative in some of those countries, and the capital markets are going out of business. So my question is simply this. We've got to address currency. It's very important. I don't think Americans quite understand the importance. How would you address currency?
Well, you're absolutely right. Currency is a critically important thing, and it's critically important in the here and now. But I don't want to distract from the other points about we need it. Once you get beyond, even if we had the currencies right, you would still have important problems in the trading system that need institutional address, are the issues that I talked about. You're also right, by the way, the view that currencies adjust automatically in response to trade deficits is a view from the past. It's from the past in a world without financial capital mobility. If there were just trade deficits and finance could not flow between countries, then that would be the case, because if you have a deficit, you need to find the money to pay for it. You have to sell your currency to acquire the other person's. That puts downward pressure. That's not the way the world is today. We opened it up to portfolio investment. We opened it up to investment to pay for the financing of factories and so on, shifting that barge around the world. And so therefore, capital markets play a very critical role. You've got two sorts of problems with regard to currency. The first is how to put a stop to the interventions, that the unfair interventions that that China is doing. There are provisions in the IMF to go through them and put a stop to it that way. There are probably some actions we could do unilaterally with offsetting interventions of our own in the markets, where we instruct the Treasury to instruct the Federal Reserve. We could make arrangements with the Europeans. Here's one of the important things that we, as the strong currency, must do. There's a reciprocal problem here. When a currency gets into difficulty, the weak currency can't defend it. You know, the central bank it doesn't have the foreign exchange to defend it. So therefore, they must have a global agreement where the strong currency, the appreciating currency, has the onus of defense to maintain the right. But you're then going to have to eventually, and you may not like this part, that's the part you like, you're going to have to tackle financial capital flows and how to put a restraint on them so you don't get these hot money flows running around the world producing these boom-bust cycles that produce damage us and damage the other countries. When they get a temporary boom, but when the money decides to flow out again, then you have a currency crisis in the developing countries. We've been through this 1980 period. We had the Reagan appreciation, very damaging. President Reagan had the wisdom to authorize the Plaza Accords, and that's where we should be going right now, something on a global currency agreement. Then we had the Clinton period of appreciation that then ended up in the East Asian bust. We've had an appreciation that really sort of continues under George Bush and under President Obama. Currency has been an issue that Wall Street and the multinational outsourcers and the piece that's most forgotten, the big box retailers who do the importing, all of them have come together to sort of gang up and make and not address this problem. So please, when you go back to Washington, it'd be great if it, we move it.
Last question, Dan Woodring.
Thank you, and I just want to say for the audience that we are going to have a 10-minute break after this panel, and then we'll be back in for the next panel. Thank you very much for the panel. I think this is a very important topic. And my final question is, you can't leave quite yet. My final question is, if we were going to do a very rapid round, could each of you suggest one concrete policy that would tend to lead to an increase in jobs in the United States, manufacturing or otherwise? Thank you very much.
Oh, we start with Alice.
Well, I can speak to the case of Florida. For us has been, we've actually seen a loss of foreign direct investment. For us, focusing on attracting more foreign direct investment, which also creates manufacturing jobs. A lot of the manufacturing that's in Florida is actually foreign manufacturing. The Japanese build a lot of things here. And so for us, it would be a focus more on foreign direct investment so we can attract, we can be much more competitive.
Stick.
So the manufacturing jobs of yesterday, low wage, low value added, labor intensive, are not coming back to the United States. The jobs of the future will be in advanced technology, smart manufacturing, high tech. Unfortunately, a recent study by Accenture showed that 80% of US manufacturing workers do not have the skills they need to be competitive in a technology-based, IT-based economy. So the best thing we could do at the national and at the state level is to invest much more in workforce retraining to and like trade adjustment assistance programs to ensure that our manufacturing workers have the skills they need to compete in the global economy, because if they have that, then we'll have companies that are competitive and can succeed and grow global market share and bring back employment.
A plaza accord on currencies, a global plaza accord, and an intelligent infrastructure program aimed to fix problems like the failing Flint water system, not to enrich private road builders and contractors.
And last word, Bryan Riley.
You said one, I have two. First, just don't screw things up, don't go backwards. And number two, about 40 to 60% of everything we import in the United States is an input or an intermediate good or a piece of machinery we use to produce something to compete in the global marketplace. So let's get rid of tariffs on those products so that it's easier to create jobs here. Thank you.
Please join me in thanking our panel.